Okay, so I just wanted to give a glimpse of how to make 3D printed parts inside of Blender and Cura. I'm currently in the process right now of deciding how I want to design this part. I have a rudder assembly that I'm creating. So this is the rudder that's already made. This is the tiller area, I would say. And this is the cap. I need to design something that'll attach to the cap that allows both of the linkages to turn together. And at this end here, you imagine there's a servo with a push rod that's pushing this along. So I want to design a part that will allow the push rod to work. And for that, it should be pretty easy. We'll choose to create a cube. Place it along here. Scale it to the appropriate size. I want it to be at the same height, and press ground. It's not going to grab it because of the lack of vertices, so I'm going to add a vertex here. Select all, grab Y, and there we go. Now it's aligned to the center. Now what I want to do is to grab it out to the side. Roughly here will work for me. And then I'll be able to extrude this upwards. Grab X, then select all, and we're gonna scale it on the Y axis. Something convenient, so I believe that's roughly correct. And my goal here is just to provide a place for a bar to come and hook in, so it really is a hook. So for this, I want to select my bottom part and make it go upwards. And then we're going to create a few spaces where the hook can attach. So to do that, we're going to require some cylinders that are representative of the holes we want to pierce. If I go in this view and I place the cylinder correctly, okay, we'll see here that we are able to snap. So let's grab Y, there we go. Now I'll set the origin back to the center because the origin has been moved. There we go. Now is the origin going to the center. To pierce a hole, we just scale it to the appropriate size, and then I'd want to scale it vertically so it's rather large compared to. And then I have to decide what the size of the hole is. I'm assuming these boxes are about 2 millimeters wide in my final design. And each one of these boxes represents a centimeter, and each one of these represents a decimeter. Roughly 2 millimeters should be large enough for the hole that I'm attempting, but I'll go a little bigger. So this is about 3. Yep. And that should allow me to hook whatever I need into it. After doing this, we'll choose to add an array modifier. Generally with assemblies like this, you have a couple of holes to decide from, because your lever arm can be shorter or longer, and that affects how much travel your servo arm gets. So just using the factors here in the array modifier, I'll be able to change this as I want it. So when you attach the servo further out, then there's less travel, more accuracy. If you move it in, it's harder to move, but there's more travel. Then we would add a modifier, in this case a boolean, and pierce our holes. Once we apply that modifier and move the holes out of the way, we'll see that our shape has a hole here. Now, I have an add-on called Booltron. You can download it by just searching for it. If you do Booltron GitHub, let's say, and see here I have it. You would just go in code and hit download zip, and then that zip, well, it tells you here, you would install the add-ons. Excuse me. So here I'll just refine a little bit of my shape. I like to add a bevel, because that's how horns are usually made. So you use Control B to add a bevel, and use your scroll wheel to add a few more details. Now, as I was saying, we should be able to union these. And very great job. Let's see. I was, sort of counting on this for my work to proceed. So the other thing we need to do, unfortunately Blender does not have very good possibilities for working in the 3D modeling. We need to count the number of vertices here. So we have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think that if I do the same number of loop cuts here, and then we'll 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 should be good. We'll be able to join the vertices together, which is not as convenient as it might be, but hey, it works. So, and here I'm just, if I grab and don't tell it where to go, just snap to the nearest vertex. Okay, let's do the same thing along this bottom edge, this time selecting the vertices themselves and attaching them to the shape that's behind. Now this shape and this shape should be perfectly fitted to each other and without adding any geometry. So then we'll join these two so that we can remove the vertices that are together. So we do merge by distance. And then what should happen is that we'll have possibly an extra few faces in here, but we know we can delete them, right? So if I do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and just X, edges and faces, that we should be seeing the other side. Oh, actually, no, that's the wrong side. That's the wrong face. I have to go inside here, and there we go. This is the correct set of faces. I can just delete that, and then we should see the whole assembly inside. This is where the rudder arm would come in, and then it's all one piece. The idea here is that you need to have something where every part of the 3D printed piece reflects an element of a wall inside your 3D printed model. If you have meshes that intersect, that's the reason we join them. If they intersect, what will happen is you export it to Cura, and then the elements, they kind of subtract from each other and they don't join together. So you get these weird shapes inside of Cura that don't make much sense. Okay, another part of what I need to do is add a, and this is kind of a test, but I need to add a fulcrum element to what I'm making. Now here I'll place the cursor closer because it's not very convenient. So if I place the cursor there, then when I create a new item, it'll appear right at the spot that I need it, or roughly so. Let's do Shift Tab to remove snapping. Wireframe view, and then just place it. Again, we want the origin to be in the middle of the geometry. And still in wireframe view, edit mode, select this, grab Z. Grab Z, yeah. Okay, grab Z here. And what I'm thinking of doing now is splitting this into two bits, there we go, and scaling like this so that I can make a part that fits into another part. We'll see it in just a second, kind of engineering this on the spot. Extruding like that will work fine. So now we have, this is much too long, but this is an area where we can have a sort of pin that slots into it, right? So let's make another cylinder this time, and then rotate on the y-axis 90 degrees. And then grab on the y-axis, there you go. And then I want to scale it down, move it, scale it down. Okay, now I need to take out my ruler and measure. Here's my ruler. Which should I put away here? See if it's in the drawer. What is my ruler? I thought I had it with me. Okay, there we go. Here's one. Alright, so with my ruler, I can measure that my rod is a 3mm rod. Here we see that I have 1, 2, 3mm here, so this would be extremely tiny. That means I have to enlarge it somewhat. And I would say probably the minimum you want to make is 1.5 to 2mm for a 3D printed part. So, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, that's about good. It's pretty minimal. Let's scale it out and straighten it. Okay. And then what I want to do is make it into some part where the metal cylinder can go inside of it. And this one will have to be exactly 3mm. If I'm still, I have a hard time seeing in the wireframe view, but you'll want to keep it just a little, slight bit larger, but not too large. I wouldn't mind if it were a snug fit because I do want the metal and the plastic to be a tight fit together. Now at this point, we can extrude on the x-axis, and I'll just remove my snapping and grab x again. And there we go. Now, when the rudders move together, they will need to pivot together. So this part won't always stay perpendicular. Because if we imagine if I rotate this, then you'd see that this bit here has to continue being straight along the axis of the other pin on the other side so that they're able to communicate the motion together. That's why I want to add a couple of pins on the top and bottom that will be 3D printed as well. So let's go in my cylinder view. Cylinder view. It's not really a view as much as it's just a part. Okay, so here I'm going to do my best to add a cylinder on top, and I don't know how I can merge them together if my Boolean modifier doesn't work properly this time. Let's see what happens. Let's first what I want to do. Okay, this is my top pin, right? Let's add it to the bottom as well. So I'll do Shift Z. I don't know if this is a good size for it. I assume, yeah, 3mm should be good enough to be 3D printed and work well. Not measuring very precisely. I'm going by eye here. So once I do this, I can join these both together, and then I'll be able to union them together. But this one seems to have worked a little better. There we go. That's exactly what I want to happen. So as you can see, all the edges are the edges that will be exposed to the air, and there are no other edges inside the part itself. Except I should probably hide this so that we can see better. So yeah. No edges inside the part, that's what you want, because you have to imagine all the volume of this part is filled with plastic. And that's how your G-code file, you know, generated through Cura will read it. Okay, so now that we have this, let me just probably had my cube somewhere here. In any case, it doesn't really matter because I had the wrong size. So I'll just go back here for a second. You'll notice if you're in edit mode, when you change the position of an object, it also changes its origin compared to that position. But otherwise, if you're in the general object mode, that doesn't happen. Okay, so here we want this to be close enough to be tight. I'll just concentrate on this view for right now. So I'm expecting to have something exactly like this, and I want my parts to fit very tightly and snugly together. So I'll do scale on the z-axis. And, you know, plastic bends a little bit, so it doesn't matter if they're quite tight. That down. Now I can focus more on the other side. So if I do 7, that's vertical. 7 on your numpad. And then would want something roughly like this. So then I have to decide what thickness I need this to be. I probably don't need it more than 3 millimeters. So we can scale that down to about 3 millimeters. And then what I'd like to have is a piercing that goes through. So I could use this part, but it's not going the whole way through. To make it go the whole way through, let's just use another cylinder. This cylinder could be a bit larger because I do want some lenience in the size so that these parts are able to rotate with each other. So I'll scale Z, and then I'll just scale it out a little bit more. And what I'm expecting is for this plastic to be a little flexible and to be able to snap the other part into place. I do think that, as I look at it now, snapping will be a little bit difficult with this part that's so tall. The ends of it are protruding quite widely. I'm sorry, I moved my own cylinder. There we go. I do need to use this as a bullion to pierce later, but I just want to make sure this part. So I'll scale Z, and I think almost 2 millimeters is actually quite a bit to snap into place. It just needs to be strong enough. That's my only concern. And this can't be, you know, can't lack flexibility either. But it still has to be stiff. So I think this will work. I think this will work. And I can always test it out with my print later. I will also make sure to leave enough space for the part to move. So I'm moving it more towards this end, biased towards that edge. And then we're finally ready to do our bullion, but let's first make sure that the vertical side is also correct. And I'm kind of aligning myself on old work here, but that's fine. Okay, so we do need to have the right height to connect properly, and I think that by, okay, let's get the width right. So if I select all by doing A and scale on the x-axis, there we go. Now I'm kind of looking at this, right, because I know that the other time it didn't work so well. I might have to do it manually. Then I'm expecting to have to move this to be aligned with the bottom edge. Now let's make sure that we're not going too far out. I'd see this as a good size to start with. Okay. Yeah, that looks solid and looks like it'll work. If I do Alt and click, it'll select everything. Then I'll want this to be grabbed on the x-axis. Remove that part so it's aligned with the hole. Then I think we're safe to now boolean the hole. So let's choose the difference. Wrong way. There we go. And there we see our part taking shape. It's most likely that it would be more solid if the edges are kind of cambered. So I'll do Control B, and this will allow me to add some geometry here. It probably won't get in the way because this is already a curved surface. Then And I would like to do the same thing here because these bits of plastic are probably not very useful. So a round shape seems appropriate here. Then that should allow us to go in this view, kind of decide, okay, where do we want to go with this shape? I don't really see any use in having a very tall structure here. The plastic seems thick enough to me, so if I do measure by distance, then I'll remove that one. And then I might be able to also come down, you know, roughly here. Have that distance gone as well. Okay, that seems rather reasonable to me. It still does look thick. I don't know if I could reduce it. Maybe I should reduce it to that height here. And then this one, reduce it here. But I do have to keep in mind, sometimes it's hard to see the scale of things when you're building them on a 3D environment. So I have to keep in mind it might be smaller than I'm imagining in my head. But it should work. Now here, let's see if the union works. It doesn't look like it's... Oh! Is it giving a nice result? I think the problem might come from the fact that the part is going inside the other one. I'm not sure the best way I can use to fix that. So instead of union, well, let's just try. Let's see in case it does work. As I said before, I'm not a fanboy of having to do this, but there really isn't a choice. Okay, so let's go out here. I see this is still going a little. Let me cheat first. See if it works. That. So now let's do a union. Let's see what happens here. Is it looking kind of okay? It's looking reasonable. I think that actually works. Maybe. This is because, it's another story, but here, let me hide this, just H to hide it. And see, okay, yeah, that's the problem. When geometry intersects like this, this will not work in a 3D print at all. So, there we go. Intersections, they're going to negate each other, and it's going to create a void. It'll be super weird in Cura. I mean, maybe it works in other slicers, I don't know, but in Cura it does not work at all. So, let's forget about having done that. Instead, I'm going to have to slice this into 7 bits. Did I? I think I had scaled something down, right? Yeah, there we go. Okay. So, same process as before. Control R, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There we go. And that's the size that we want. Now we can go in the wireframe mode. And I would like to, first of all, move these to the same height as their peers, and then grab these and move them to the correct corners. Goody goody. This will buy it. It'll require a little bit of imaginative modification. So. I think we'll have to move these elements. Side, and you kind of have to see through everything, figure out which geometry is what. We do have a corner there. Corner here. Okay, looking good. And now, we should be able to select this one and fit it to this geometry, kind of the midsection. I'd have to do more tests to determine exactly what the Boltron modifier can do to help me out with the 3D prints. As you saw, it did work. Once. Alright. These look like they're close together to me. Looks to me like the vertices are close together. Of course, this bit here won't print very solidly, honestly. So, might be better to just bring it together with the other one. Of course, we have doubled up vertices, so we do merge by distance to remove the double ups. And what you'll find is that when you print this, it won't look exactly correct, because for example, here, in this shape, you might have diagonal that's going from here to there, because all the vertices have to be on the same plane for it to be able to print. So you might have awkward diagonals going through, but as this is a purely utilitarian part, it doesn't matter if the diagonals are not precise. So I don't care what it looks like, is what I'm saying. Let's try to union now. Let's just join first. And then merge by distance. You would have seen before, the reason I'm doing merge by distance is that we have one vertex here and another there. And when you do merge by distance, what happens is that it finds the vertices that are close together. So now they're not ripping apart, they're together. So that means I can go inside the model somewhere. Wow, I'll have to really figure out how to see through this. I believe this is the spot that I'm looking for right now. Here's our corner. Here's the corner. Yeah. And this is the interior. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, and I ripped something open. I selected the last one. So on the edges and faces. And there we go. Now the volume should be complete. You see we're going through the pin here, the hole. Everything works together, I think. If we do a wireframe view, this is how it goes. And honestly, a lot of this I feel like should be part of Blender, but because Blender is often used for artistic uses instead of being used for 3D printing, it doesn't necessarily have all the utilities that would be required or are best convenient for hard surface modeling, like we're doing here. Okay, so now we can conveniently see what my piece does. If I just illustrate, I would add a cylinder here, rotate X, Y, or Y, and then scale it down. I have a piece of metal, a rod to be exact, that goes about here, and then it stretches out across to the other rudder on the other side, and then this bit repeats itself, except that this one here is rotated 180 degrees, so my piece of metal is stuck inside. It's a 3mm piece of metal. This side probably doesn't need this, but so you can see that when this rotates here, then this joint would follow, and then this would follow, and this would follow, and then this would rotate. And because it's on an axis, it turns the rudder, so the rudder, instead of being there, is like this. So I think that gives you an idea, and of course you have a rudder on the other side. You can kind of see what I'm going for here. So it's going to be a system that looks like that, but you know, I only need one side of it to be able to print it. So now let's go into Cura and see how we do the Cura exporting. First off, let me turn on Cura. It does take a little while to turn on, so let's do that first. And delete this, we don't need it. So here I would call that the horn. This is a horn, servo horn. We do file export to STL. Selection only is very important because you don't want to export the whole mesh, you just want to export this little bit of it. And then everything else is fine. I'll do servo horn here and export to STL. All right. Now inside Blender, I happen to have a folder, I think. It's here, and it should have exported it. So we should have our servo horn.stl. So if I move it into Kira, we can see our shape now. And this would be way too small. I happen to know that it reduces the size by one, by a factor of 10. So if I do hit 0 and hit tab, it'll put all of them up by a factor of 10. This is the real size. My bed is about a decimeter wide and tall. So I have to decide here what exactly my print should look like. Since I don't really mind what the bottom of it is, I don't care if there are supports on the bottom, so I do think this is okay. And I have a finer setting. Yeah, that should be good for the type of part and size that it is. So I do a preview of that. This is how the print will look like. There will be supports here, and this is completely flat, so there are no supports, which is great. The only problem is that here, this won't work very well because this will completely sag since it's a vertical piece. So I do believe there is some setting that I have turned off that is not allowing me to do this. Another part that I forgot is that I might want to have a hole here in case, to put my screw where I want to attach the warden. So let's do that really fast. Do mesh, cylinder. Go into wireframe view. Scale it down. Scale it up. I believe this is about right. X. And then be able to pierce my hole. I do believe I have to select the boolean first, and then I do difference. Yep. Now we have our hole, so we export it again. File, export, STL, servo horn. Then it's going to be red because we're crushing the other file. And then this one, I'm going to do an export of it as well. So we're going to do export STL, servo horn, connector. Right? And then it should be alphabetical, so servo. Did it export? Sometimes refreshing works. What happened? Let's do it again. Maybe I forgot to check the selection only. Yeah, I did. No. Servo horn connector. Then do export STL. Come back inside here. Okay, there we go. This one and this one. Let's drag them in. Okay, now for whatever reason, it's scaling the wrong scale. And also it exported two of them. Oh, I named them both the same. I totally see what happened now. Dear, dear me. This one was exported with the same name as the other one. This one should be called servo horn and should not be crushed by the other one. Okay, go here. Servo horn. Go. This should be by a factor of 1000. And if we move, should be able to print these parts together. Except that this one, I do want to rotate it vertically, because I think that'll give a better print. And this one, I have to select the settings for support. The support placement everywhere, I believe, is what it's going. Because touching build plate would be only not above itself. So I do want to have supports that are above themselves. So as you can see here, this would be filled with supports, which is perfect. This will have a little bit of support, but it's not a big deal. It's very tiny, so it should hold perfectly, and this has supports as well. I don't really care what's under there because my pins go through. The only place that I really care that it's smooth is this surface here. Now this may cause some problems. It might be difficult to remove this from the interior of the part, but it'll do for a first test run. So then we're going to save to file, and once I save to file, I'll be able to use it in my 3D printer.